Now, speaking of Whitney, her cousin Dion, what's the history there?
That was my girlfriend.
Wait, what?
Wow.
Hold on now.
What are your feelings on where music is now? The technology and social media and the way people are consuming it. It's a different beast.
I hate streaming.
To have a career, have longevity for as long as you all have had, like, what is that one nugget that you can give anybody out there that's looking to have a career?
You're contagious.
Yes, Lord.
Touch me, baby.
Don't make me get on the piano now.
Who is the Isley Brothers Mount Rushmore of music?
We sound crazy.
My Lord. Welcome to another week of We Sound Crazy. Your boy Phillionaire is here in St. Louis.
Claude Kelly is also here in the St. Louis.
And Chuck Harmony is in his hometown, St. Louis.
You know, I'm Bacon and I'm from Macon, Georgia, but I'm in the Lou. And I'm so glad to be in the Lou right now. Man, yeah, man. What a time.
Welcome to my hometown, y'all.
We like it.
Feels y'all good like to be it? Here, Chuck.
I like it. Yeah, we might stay a little while. Yeah.
This ain't the South, but I've been getting a lot of Southern hospitality since I've been here.
I heard my mom cook for you last
Listen,
night.
Listen, she fed us good last night. Shout out to Mama Chuck.
Mama Chuck.
The world about to get fed right now.
They're about to get fed.
I mean, normally, y'all, I do the intro solo, but the CVS receipt of receipts and awards it's and crazy. Honors. It's crazy. We had to divvy it up. So I'm going to kick it off.
Okay.
Kick it off.
Okay. This week we got, now here's the thing. Look into the camera and listen to me, Claude. If you're in the car listening, if you're listening to the podcast, the audio version.
Yes, sir.
We toss the word legend around way too much. But this week on We Sound Crazy, we have two legends.
Two legends, bro.
And I mean it.
Two legends, man.
And if you want to at me on social media, go for it, because I'm here for it. But so, without further ado, we are sitting with Grammy winners. Also, by the way, Grammy Lifetime Achievement Award inductees.
Yes.
Also, they were presented the Lifetime Achievement Award by the RIAA the end of 2022.
That part. Well, Phil, I got you on that one. When you see longevity, their picture. Is right next to it in the dictionary.
Yeah.
They're among one of the few groups to have hit the Billboard Hot 100. And not one, not two, not three, not four, but eight different decades.
Yeah, man.
I could beat that.
Okay.
What you Rock got? And Roll Hall of Fame inductees.
Man. Wow.
Songwriter Hall of Fame inductees. And by the way, as someone who graduated from Berklee College of Music myself.
Yeah.
Honorary doctorates from the Berklee College of Music in
That's
Boston.
Crazy.
Super proud.
And I can beat that.
Okay? Let's see.
Because to this day, like right now in 2023, they are the most played indie R&B artists and the second most played of all artists as R&B.
Major and indie.
Major and independent.
That's literally in the music industry.
That's today.
Right
today.
Now.
That's today. Right now.
New album's out right now.
Amazing.
You see this? Right here. Without further ado, make some noise. The Isley Brothers in the building.
We are honored to be in your presence. Honored.
Wow. Yeah. That's a lot, right?
That's a lot.
I didn't know we did all that stuff.
Surprise, surprise.
Wow. Man, it like for me, this is like so legendary because I grew up down the road in East St. Louis and then I come here to St. Louis and I enter the house of a king.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? And so I want to know as an East St. Louisan, what is so special about St. Louis that it could house the kings of rock and roll?
Good question.
You know, there's so many great people that's been here in St. Louis, you know? And when it was given me and Ernie a star, you know, I was just Miles Davis.
Yeah, man.
I say, well.
Chuck Berry.
Chuck Berry.
Well, we're just glad to be a part of that.
Yeah, man.
The architects claimed St. Louis, the Architects.
Yeah.
I'm talking about Miles Davis, and I mean it's the same legacy. Wow. So of all the things that we just mentioned, I mean, sometimes those things can go over your head. It's a lot of accolades. Mm-hmm. What stands out to you all as a special moment? Do those matter? Do those things matter to you, or is it really about the music? Or do you care about the awards and the record breaking?
We care about the records, man.
Okay.
When you hear it on the radio, mm-hmm. and we see the people, and you can talk about it like mm-hmm. we're talking about it now.
Yeah.
That's what's important. Mm. Yeah.
And
yeah.
And the records live on.
Oh yeah. And it's about 20 years. What year was that we did Footsteps?
77.
Yeah.
77.
1974.
And it still goes off today.
Years.
Right. Yeah. And it still goes off today.
Yeah.
When you hear them, we hear songs like Footsteps, do you remember the writing? Do you remember the studio sessions and what was going on at those times?
I remember playing it 400 times after I recorded it. Yeah. And Ernie wrote that song, man. Me and my oldest brother, we'd sit in a room and played it 400 times.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Did you know it would last this long?
Yes.
That's what I wanted to hear. Yeah. That's what I wanted to hear.
I want to know, we just talked about you all being around, you all have had hits in 8 different decades. That is unheard of.
It is.
What is your philosophy or the thought process behind changing with the times, staying relevant, making music? Because I think all of us in this room, we could probably go to one of our own respective family reunions, and everybody at the family reunion has a connection with something Isley Brothers related.
Yeah.
What is the thought process behind just staying with the times, staying connected to the world in the way that you have for so long?
For me, it's God's blessing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad to be able to sing
yeah. mm-hmm.
the songs that we want to sing. And I know this is a gift from God.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It really is.
Because originally the Isley Brothers was actually a gospel group.
Yeah.
Yes.
Wow.
Yeah.
So how did the group go from gospel to secular?
Well, my father wanted us to sing everything, country and western, gospel, just everything. And so that's what we did. Now, my brother Kelly, it was into Clyde McFadder. So he taught me everything about Clyde McFadder and the Dominoes and like all the people who were out. My mother taught me all the stuff about Donna Washington, mm-hmm. Nat King Cole, and you know, and I was singing when I was 2 years old, you know. And Clara Ward, mm-hmm. I got over.
Yeah.
And so every time I would come home from school, she would go through a list of songs, you know. I didn't pay it no attention, you know. I just wanted to finish that and get outside, you know. And it grew from there.
That's the best education.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, my brother Ernie is playing baseball when he came and moved to New Jersey. Mm. And Jimi Hendrix was in the house.
Wait.
Because Jimi Hendrix was originally at one point in the Isley from 63 to 65. Is my
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'll let Ernie tell you that story.
Please tell us that story, yeah. Mr. Ernie.
Because Ronald and Kelly were looking for a guitar player, and they found this guy in Greenwich Village, mm-hmm. and he was left-handed. Mm. He had a reputation, but they wanted him to play something, and they got his guitar for him out the pawn shop and got him a set of strings, and he strung his guitar up, and he started playing, and it's like, wow, man, guy was hired, but he didn't have a place to stay. So it was suggested that he come to New Jersey and stay in the house that our mother and me and Marvin were at. Hmm. And that was March of 63. And I was 11 years old and Marvin was 10. They got him his first Fender guitar. Hmm. And, you know, every time he was playing, I would figure out a way to be out in the room with him. Mm. You know, I'd have a social studies book with me, but I was listening.
Studying.
And observing.
Yeah.
You know, and when the Beatles came on Ed Sullivan in February of 64, and ladies and gentlemen, the Beatles. And I'm on the left-hand side of the couch, and Marvin's on the right-hand side of the couch, and Jimi Hendrix is in the middle between us. Right. And a couple of days went by, and there was a meeting between the band and the brothers, and one of the things Kelly said was, this English group is, that's no hype, that's legit. Mm-hmm. But I think we're going to be all right because they do Shout and Twist and Shout before they came to America. Mm-hmm. Now, Kelly said, now they got two guitar players, but we got Jimmy.
Hello.
And,
when,
and he said it just like that. And when he said it, but we got Jimmy, I looked over at Jimmy, and Jimmy was grinning ear to ear at that remark, and, because it was true.
Yeah.
So his best. He was the best, you know, and I'm glad that today to see that they recognize him as the number one best player. Yes, that's wonderful.
You guys can confirm that he actually is the number one best player.
Yes,
that's, of course.
That's the receipts right there. Yeah, not everyone should say they know. Yeah. Y'all know.
Yeah.
So Ernie, I have to ask you, I mean, because you were a teenager, your older brothers were already releasing music on about, how did it go from you as a 14-year-old, which I believe is when you first started to...
I was playing drums for my brothers for the first time at 14 in Philly. And
so did you want to be in the group, or you were just like, I'm just hanging with my brothers?
Oh, no. You know, I think at a certain point, something can turn on. And you start doing different things, or you'd be attracted to music and attracted to instruments. And so I was playing drums, started at 12, played my first live gig at 14. I'm the bass player on the record, It's Your Thing.
It's your thing, do what you wanna do. I can't tell you.
I was 16 at the time we recorded it. And, you know, I got my first guitar when I was 16. And, of course, if Jimmy had been around when That Lady came out, he'd be laughing. Because he would know, that's...
Ernie.
And Kelly would have had him in the corner.
Oh, wow.
By the front door. I told you, man.
So...
He would have been laughing.
Yeah. Normally, when we have conversations on this on our podcast, the guests have... a couple of hits,
yeah,
right. But thus far, we've already heard mention of Shout, Twist and Shout,
yeah,
That Lady,
Footsteps,
Footsteps. I'm forgetting one, and there's many more to come. But the catalog is so deep. Mm. But I want to start with Shout, because Shout is one of those songs that is an, I would say, an American songbook classic.
Yeah, for sure.
Obviously an international classic, but when you talk about songs that will, if you were to leave a time capsule about American music and 3,000 years from now, they want to know what was going on, Shout should be one of the first songs that's in there.
Absolutely. Yeah.
It changed the course of rock and roll. That song specifically, what was it like watching the first hit become a hit?
You know, and that's what I'm talking about, God.
Mm-hmm.
We were on the stage in Philadelphia with Georgie Woods singing Lonely Teardrops.
Mm-hmm.
And I start saying, you know, you make me want to shout. And the people were doing it. I start singing what they were doing. Mm-hmm. Keep my heels up. Throw my hands up.
Wow.
Throw my head back. Mm-hmm. Come on now. And people were shouting, falling in the floor, everything like that.
Yeah.
And after we left that gig, came back to New York, talking to Hugo and Luigi, we're telling them about the story. Mm. He said, why don't you invite some of your friends to the studio and do that song? And we try to, you know, create that song. And I sang it one time.
Mm. One time?
One time.
One take.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
And the rest is history. And some of my friends there. This song went crazy.
Yes.
Yeah. A little bit softer now. A little bit louder now. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And they were saying softer. Do it softer.
You know you make me wanna shout, kick my heels up and shout, throw my hands up and shout, throw my head back and shout, come on now.
See, people don't realize, especially songwriters out there, they don't realize that sometimes you go in a room and you plan to write a song. Mm-hmm. Other times you let, like you said, you let God move, and sometimes you're on stage or in a rehearsal. And something comes out, and that becomes a song.
So for
Shout to come from just the reaction of the energy of the crowd,
really
makes it the people's anthem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I would call it the people's anthem.
I agree.
Yeah.
You know, Ernie is one of the greatest songwriters.
I'm sitting next to one of my heroes here. That's why I'm sweating like I'm... You see me sweating over here. I'm like, Lord, I got to get myself together. Because these are... It's poetry. It's masterful. The chords and the lyrics are not just, there's no wasted space.
Yeah.
You know, we finished the Live It Up album in 74 out in Los Angeles. And it was decided that our mother and nieces and nephews and the wives would come out to LA, and we were going to go to Disneyland. I was going to go to Disneyland for the very first time in my life. I was 22 at the time. And I jumped in the shower. And for some reason, I started reciting or singing, time is truly wasting. Mm. There's no guarantee.
Wow.
Smile is in the making. Fight the powers that be.
Jesus.
And I was like, oh. I jumped out the shower. Soap went that way. Shower went that way. Water was everywhere. And I got myself a piece of paper and pencil and dripping all over it, and wrote that down and put it in my hip pocket that day that we went out to Disneyland. Mm-hmm. And I didn't say nothing about that song to the brothers until like 2 or 3 months later, but that was Fight the Power.
I was truly wasted. There's no guarantee.
That Fight the Power is literally one of my favorites. Like, I remember growing up at family functions, they playing that song, and as a kid, not really registering then what those words meant.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But as I've gotten older and I actually pay attention to what's happening in the world, unfortunately, that song is still relevant.
In every way.
Today.
Yeah. Yes.
Harvest of the World.
Harvest of the World. Yeah. Like, you all have been super, like, you... Throughout the entire catalog, there are a lot of socially conscious records. Mm-hmm. How important was that for you all back then and even now, to kind of have music that reflect what was happening?
Well, we were always pursuing the music anyhow.
Yeah.
Mm. Whatever we were doing. So I happened to go down to Manny's Music and got a 12-string guitar, which I still have. Mm-hmm. And I got in the basement and tuned it and started playing. And get inspired. You know, all babies together, everyone's a seed. Half of us are satisfied, half of us in need. Love's bountiful in us, tarnished by our greed. When will there be a harvest for the world?
Ugh, Jesus.
And then I did the second verse. And just so happened, as I was finishing up the second verse, Marvin and Chris came in. And hey, man, what are you playing? And I started playing this song and singing it. And they looked at me like, how?
Kind of how I'm looking right now.
How did you come up with that one? I was like, hey, man, I like the sound of the tone of the guitar. And it's brand new, and I'm playing it, and got inspired. And that was how, you know, the Harvest for the World came about. But we were always pursuing the music. I remember one time I came into Ronald's house. He was sitting at the piano playing these chords, four notes in the right hand. Mm. And he was playing it, not in tempo, but playing it. And it sounded really good. And he asked Chris to sit down and start playing it. And that song turned out to be "I'm Taking Care of Business, mm-hmm. Woman, Can't You See? I gotta make it for you, I gotta make it for me. Sometimes it feels like I'm neglecting you. I'd love to spend more time, I got so many things to do. I got work to do, I got a job. Yeah, and it's like, man, you know, so when we got in the studio and did it, it's like, wow. You know, that was, Vanessa Williams has done it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Yeah.
Average White Band.
Yeah.
I know Ringo Starr does it on tour.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we've always had, been in pursuit of the song, of the music. Mm. There was a commercial. It used to come on. You can still find it on your computer from Chanel No. 5. And I used to love it with a man and a woman in a swimming pool and all that. And he dove in the pool at the far end and came up through her leg. And I loved that commercial. And I had my guitar with me and I started playing it. And then I started singing like, "Hey girl, ain't no mystery."
Oh my goodness.
What in the world? At least, as far as I could see, I want to keep you here, laying next to me.
Jesus.
Hey girl,
yes, sir.
And Chris grabbed a notepad and said, "Sharon, I love between the sheets." Right. Yeah. And Marvin finished the rest of the lyric in that song.
That's crazy. Speaking of,
I love it when you call me Big Pop. Throw your hands in the air if you's a true player. I love it when you call me Big Pop. To the honeys, get your money, player fellas.
So many samples. When I think arguably one of the most sample catalogs has to be the Isley Brothers catalog.
Yeah, yeah,
it might be the most.
From Biggie to Ice Cube to Kendrick Lamar to Jay-Z, the list goes on and on and on.
Yeah. Yes.
I got to ask y'all, how do you feel about people sampling and or covering your music?
Good question.
It's the greatest feel, you know? Mm. You know, when we passed up James Brown, at first, it was James Brown had the most samples, and we passed that up, man. It's and we run into the rappers, and meet some of the rappers after that. And when I met
Kendrick Lamar,
Kendrick Lamar, his mother wanted him to meet me, and he said she wanted him to do one of our songs.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
And that's how he did "Who's That Lady."
Wow.
Yeah.
And they came here at the studio. We had a studio with a girl by the name of Aura. And we did the song at the studio, man. He stayed here for a couple of days.
Mm.
And that song won a Grammy Award.
Yeah, it did.
You know, when Ernie wrote the song "Fight the Power," and we recorded that, it changed our, we were able to draw 40,000 people at Madison Square Garden in New York and that type of thing.
Mm.
And then that song changed the Isley Brothers.
Mm. Yeah. Mm.
And then later on we did the song "Hello, It's Me."
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I started doing a lot of slow songs and that became the favorite. So between those fast songs that we did and those slow songs, I think that kept the Isley Brothers where we could go anywhere.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So 8 decades of music, being in the studio. What's your favorite decade to be in the studio? It was the most magical?
That's good.
Wow.
That's a good question.
That's a good question.
That's a good question.
I had so much fun with R. Kelly.
Yeah, man.
Yes.
When we started doing the Down Low, he would tape when I walked in the studio.
Yeah, man.
And he said, you know, hey, Mr. Big, so. And we put that together right there in the studio, you know. Wow. But he knew that's what he wanted to do, you know. Mm-hmm. And
another genius musician.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Another genius musician.
I spent months and months and months and months with my wife and her sister out there.
Shout out to JS.
Shout out to JS.
Yeah, man.
Come on.
Come and get a scoop of my...
Come on.
What?
Yes, sir.
Come on. Yes, sir. Well, that's what I'm talking about.
Come on. Yeah. But, so, Mr. Biggs, how did Rob just walk in the studio one day, it was Mr. Biggs? Like, that's how it just started?
He told me when we first met, he said, you're going to be Mr. Biggs. And I'm standing there listening. He said, you're the Mr. Biggs in the music business, you know. So he came up with that, you know.
Listen, that whole, this is Mr. Biggs. How you doing, Mr. Biggs? What the hell is going on? Listen, and that Kelly, come take this phone. All of that stuff was just.
That's
our line.
Yeah. That's our line, we say it all the time.
Because it's theater.
It's a
hit record, but mm-hmm. the theater of it and the way you all were able to create characters and tell stories that were happening in real people's lives.
Yeah.
And it was continuous too. Like, it started with Download, then it went into the Kelly Price.
Right.
Then it went into the Contain. Like, it was the genius behind, let's continue this story.
Right.
Yeah.
And it literally introduced, because for us growing up in the 90s, it was like, okay, this is the Isley Brothers, the Ronald Isley that we identify with.
100%.
My mama playing the old records, but this is for us. So yeah, it's amazing. Crazy.
You know, when I signed Kelly Price to our label, and she did the song Friend of Mine, mm-hmm. and R. Kelly heard it, you know, later on, he said, hey, come out to Chicago. And he did the remix of it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's when we did all that talking. This is Mr. Big.
Let's talk about Kelly Price for a second.
I want to talk about Kelly Price because I think it's T-Neck Records.
Yes.
And, which they founded in 69.
Yep.
But before Kelly Price, and correct me if my research is wrong, but Jimi Hendrix released music through T-Neck as well.
Yes. Mm. Yes. That was the first record.
Yes.
Yeah, Testify. Mm-hmm.
Testify, yeah.
So T-Neck goes from Jimi Hendrix. So Kelly Price, many people may assume that the Isley Brothers and Kelly Price, but like Jimmy was a part of that early
Jimmy,
on.
Jimmy, yeah. Kelly. Now, Kelly is, in my opinion, a staple of R&B music in ways that I don't think she even gets the credit for, because she's vocally, both backgrounds and lead, she's been a part of so, I mean, it's Holiday Time. And we love Mariah Carey, but the backgrounds on that, All I Want for Christmas, is all Kelly Price and her sister, and Melanie Daniels and all of them. So what did you see in a young Kelly Price that made you sign her to T-Neck? Because that was a brilliant move.
Oh, she was we were doing a remix with Diddy.
The Float On?
Yeah. And so I heard her. She started singing. I said, hey, what are you doing? She said, you know, she was at us. I said, you should be making your own records, you know. And so I talked to her for a while, and she was happy about that, and went to McDonald's and bought some hamburgers or something. Anyway, hey, man, I thought she was the closest, my closest friend was Aretha Franklin. Aretha Franklin,
mm-hmm.
and I thought she could do some of the things that Aretha Franklin could do, you know, and I was right about that.
You sure were right about that.
Yeah. Wow.
To say that Aretha Franklin was one of your closest friends is a nice flex that most people cannot say.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
What are some of your fond memories of the Queen of Soul?
All the way up until the end, we would talk to all every once. Just every day. I don't want to say every day, but it wasn't every day, but it's
almost like every day.
Mm-hmm.
Even when she was sick, me and my wife was. She was asking us, who should play my part? And I said, Holly Berry.
Mm.
And my wife said, Jennifer Hudson.
Yeah. Mm.
and we argued about that. And I thought that she should sing her own songs. Mm-hmm. I know Jennifer's a great singer, mm-hmm. but I thought it would be better, just like when Jamie did Ray Charles. Ray, yeah. Ray Charles was, he's imitating Ray Charles. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because no one can sing Aretha with the feeling, you know? Yeah. But they did it a different way. But her last words were to Jennifer was, she sang a song for him, and said, you know who that is? She said, that's the Isley Brothers. She said, of course, Jennifer knew, you know? And Jennifer told us that on her TV show.
Wow.
But Aretha Franklin, she was one of the greatest. Her, along with Sam Cooke.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He was one of the greatest.
Coldest. Yeah.
Cold-hearted. Yeah. But he was one of the greatest. And Clyde McFadder.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Jackie Wilson.
Yeah. Yes.
And let's not forget Michael Jackson.
Let us not forget. Let's never forget Michael Jackson.
The greatest entertainer in the world.
Absolutely. Yeah.
You're mentioning a lot of legends. Is there a similarity in all legends? Like, is there something that all legends have to possess to become a legend, or is it just?
Michael Jackson would do a lot of things that I did first.
Mm-hmm.
All the time. And Ernie, he came up to Ernie one time, and we were on the same company, CBS,
mm-hmm.
and at a convention, he came over to the Ernie. And he wanted to meet me, you know.
He was scared to go over there, though.
Michael was scared to go over to me? So he came to you first?
Mm-hmm. And I took him over. I took him by the hand. Before I took him by the hand, I went over there to Ronald. It was something like out the Godfather, you know. Mm-hmm. I leaned down in Ronald's ear and said, you know, Michael Jackson wants to come over here and meet you. Is that all right? Ronald said, yes. Okay, it's all right. And I go back to my table and I take Michael by the hand like he's 6 years old. And I walk him over to where Ronald's sitting down, and I said, Michael Jackson, Ronald Isley. Ronald Isley, Michael Jackson. And the three of us just busted out laughing. And I left him alone.
After that, yeah.
Yeah, and then, you know, Michael sat at the same table as Ronald for the rest of the evening.
Mm-hmm.
And they were talking. And it's, you know, quite an experience to see that. But I know Marlon told me, I had a conversation with him. I was on the phone with Marlon about 2 hours one time. He said, you know something? Ernie, our father told us to be like y'all.
Wow.
Whoa. Yeah.
Wow.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
Wow.
Michael,
hello.
In his older years, he asked my brother, he said, he wanted to buy the song Footsteps in the Dark. Yeah, so yeah, yeah, if you sell me Billie Jean.
There we go.
Absolutely.
And that's how you do business. Right.
I know we're on the topic of some legendary people.
Yeah.
I have to ask this because I'm a huge Whitney Houston fan. And yes. I know she covered For the Love of You.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And she sampled Between the Sheets for one mm-hmm. of those days.
Mm-hmm.
And I know you all, you know her mom and her whole family. Like, what are some special memories you have of her?
She's the greatest singer.
Yeah.
Mm. The greatest singer.
Mm.
For real.
Yeah.
For real. Her and Aretha Franklin, man. Oh, man, she would fly us from Atlanta, Georgia to the studio, me and my wife. And and she was doing the song to sound like, something like It's Your Thing.
One of those days when you're driving in your car.
Yeah, between the sheets.
Yeah, she sampled.
Yes, 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 she sampled it.
And Bobby was with her, you know. Uh-huh. And Bobby, you know, Bobby is Bobby.
Bobby was Bobby.
Yeah, but she's a great, great individual.
Now, speaking of Whitney, her cousin Dion, what's the history there? Like, because that's a whole legacy of just icon right there.
That was my girlfriend.
Oh. Wait, what? Wow. Hold on now. Wait.
Yeah. Oh my.
I wasn't ready.
I'm about to sip some liquid gold right now. Yeah.
Let me go.
I was waiting on the studio story.
Yeah. What's it all about, Alfie?
You know, she was working with Burt Bacharach. Mm-hmm. And I was listening to those songs that Burt Bacharach was writing, and I wanted to sing those type of songs too. Mm-hmm. And but everybody did. We recorded for wanted us to do another Twist and Shout, mm-hmm. Or Shout.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The son of Shout, the mother of Shout.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah.
And I was able to do an album with Burt Bacharach. Maybe. 12 years ago, and I sang those songs. Mm-hmm. Alfie. And
that was the album you did the duet, Aretha duet, right? You Got a Friend, right?
No, okay. No. Now I did an album with Burt, and I think it was one of my best albums as a singer.
Yeah.
Yeah, as a singer.
I mean, Burt Bacharach again. I mean, I'm sitting next to a legend, but another legendary songwriter.
Incredible.
I mean, the stuff he's done with Dionne Warwick. I don't think people give Dionne Warwick credit for. I would say she's the first black pop star woman.
You know,
that sets the stage for Aretha and Whitney and things that happened afterwards. I mean, groundbreaking record.
And she's the queen of Twitter.
She's the queen of Twitter. And
to this day.
To this day, she's
long,
the queen of
long
Twitter.
Overdue, but she just got her Kennedy Center honors.
Yes, yeah. Long overdue.
Yeah. Long overdue. Yeah.
Wow.
So you have a history with Dionne and Whitney and, of course, the whole family.
Yeah.
Man, so when you hear these songs back from people that you obviously have influenced but love and respect, do you, as a musician, you're like, let me go back in. Do you feel competitive? Do you feel like, let me go in and do something else now? Or is it just a celebration?
No, I feel competitive. You know, we're always wanting to be first.
Okay. Mm.
Even now.
He's like, don't sleep.
Fighting.
Yeah.
These singers that's going out there now, just, hey, man, if they're for real.
Yeah.
They rap, they can rap and they can sing at the same time. You know? I can't do no steps like nobody. So I'm looking for the right song.
Yeah.
And, Ernie's trying to write.
Writing them, yeah.
Ernie, write another song like the thing that we did with Beyonce.
Yeah.
Goes through the changes in my life directions. When
make me say it again, girl.
Yeah, that was the number one most played independent song this year.
This year.
From this album. It's available now. Vinyl, CD, on Amazon, if you know. I got my copy.
That songwriting is still as strong as ever.
Is there a song on this album that really touches you?
That one touches me.
What else you want?
So who made the call to Beyonce?
I made a call to Tina, her mother.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
And we talked for a while. I said, I want to Beyonce to do something with me.
Jesus.
She said, "Well, I'm gonna be with her sometime this week." And I asked her, and I'll call you back. So after we talked some more, and hung up the phone. 5 minutes later, she called back. She said, "Yes, Paul. Ronald, she's never said yes to anybody this fast."
I know, right?
Which is a testament to how iconic. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Beyonce knows the legends when she hears it when they call. 100%.
Oh yeah, we got a chance to talk, and she went in the studio. She went into the studio in the Hamptons, and did. And
did some of her part, and the mother was crying about it, and she called us, so we were in New York. One thing I want to say about Beyonce as a person and her mother, she is one, I mean, man, she didn't want any money.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever the record did, you keep it all. Make it a gift for you.
Mm.
And just incredible things like that.
Class act.
I mean, my wife, it's wow. Yeah. Her album was coming out that month.
That's right. Same time as Renaissance. Yeah.
Yeah. And we released our record like 2 weeks after her record came out.
Mm.
And you know
that normally people don't let that happen.
Oh man, yeah, the people that worked for her was saying no, don't do that. Don't you know we do blah 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 blah.
Yeah.
Hey, we were able to do that, and her album did wonderful.
Yeah.
And you see what that song did.
Hello.
Yeah.
Top the charts.
Ernie,
top
do you charts. Have a favorite on the album?
That is one of my favorites.
That's your favorite?
So many great collaborations on the album. You got everybody from 2 Chainz to Quavo and Takeoff, Earth, Wind & Fire on the album, with Elder Barge with a dope cover of There'll Never Be.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Rick Ross is on here, Snoop Dogg. This is some great moments on this album.
It's a must-have album. And we were talking before we started filming about how it's still getting discovered and people are still falling in love with it. Even though it's been out for a couple of months, and now a couple of years now.
1 year.
But that's the beauty of powerful music, of great music, is that people keep discovering it as they've been discovering every song you've done since the beginning, generation after generation. Yeah. It's kind of what y'all do.
So collaboration wise, how do you decide, I'm gonna call 2 Chainz, I'm gonna call Earth, Wind & Fire, I'm gonna call Snoop, like, how do you make those decisions, like, for the collaborations?
Well, we're in the studio doing, something like a video.
Mm-hmm.
And someone called us and said, 2 Chainz wants to know, can he come to the studio?
Yeah.
And so this is my first time meeting him.
Mm.
He wanted to come to the studio because he wanted to talk to us about a song that he was doing. And he came to the studio and he was listening to our song. He said, man, I got to get on that. I said, get on it.
Mm.
And so he sat to the side and started writing some stuff that he wanted to say.
Mm.
And then we're getting ready to do a video of this. He said, can I be in the video? I said, yeah. He said, y'all got on some leather. I said, well, I don't know what they had on, some black leather or something. He sent his people back to get pick him some
stuff
some
up
leather and all that. And hey man, he did it, the song, and he jumped on the video. We did the song that he was having in his album.
Mm.
Can I tell him what the name of?
Oh, we sound crazy.
So you got to work with some of my favorite producers, 1500 or Nothing, Eric Hudson,
Scott Storch.
Scott Storch.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tell me about that process.
1500 Ranch, you know, who's the leader of that whole thing. He's the one that brought 2 Chainz to the studio.
Okay.
You know? Yeah. And, he told me about all the people that he had worked with. Mm-hmm. They had films of it, and you know, and he's a terrific guy, man. He's so great, man.
Mm-hmm.
And he introduced us to a lot of people out there. He introduced us to Pooh Bear.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Shout out to Pooh Bear.
Shout out to Pooh Bear.
Yeah, and I did the three songs of Pooh Bear. You know, The Plug.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Pooh Bear wrote that. And he introduced us to someone who did a lot of work with Bruno Mars and them.
Okay.
Yeah.
And maybe Phil?
James Fauntleroy.
Oh, James Fauntleroy.
Yeah. Okay. James Fauntleroy.
He introduced us to them. And we had a ball in the studio, man. I always wanted to do something with Earth, Wind, and Fire. And I was crazy about the song that the Barge Brother.
Yeah, Switch. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And we were able to bring all that together, you know. And it was nothing but so much fun to watch them in the studio, to watch the boys go in there and crying and talking about him. We go way back with the boys. And Earth, Wind, and Fire. Phil Billy is married to one of my sister-in-law. Crystal has a couple of sons with him. Mm-hmm.
You know? I didn't know that.
Wow.
Yeah. My son talked to his son every day.
Wow.
For 15, 17 years.
Yeah. That's crazy.
Yeah. Wow. It's a great...
Every day.
I love what y'all did with They'll Never Be. Yeah. Sounds incredible. Yeah, just to think you got the Isleys, Earth, Wind, and Fire, and El DeBarge all on one song.
It's not fair.
But when I think we talk about children, Ernie, your daughter, Alex. I cannot leave this seat.
Alex.
I cannot.
Yeah.
Let's discuss it.
She's killing the game, man.
One of my favorites right now. Like, for real.
The legacy continues.
The legacy continues. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How proud are you?
I'm proud as a papa could ever be.
She's, man.
She impressed me when she was singing the Sesame Street song in a high chair. With diapers on.
All the way back then.
You know, so I knew something was bound to happen.
Yeah.
But where she has grown to now and continues to grow is phenomenal. And, you know, it's just amazing to see that happen for her. In her own right, and for there to still be the connection family-wise.
That's
a great thing.
Yeah, we just mentioned Earth, Wind, and Fire, and you all did the verses with them a couple years ago.
That's right, yeah.
And I know for a lot of us, that was the first time that we were able to kind of, I know for me, that was the first time I connected with my family after the world went left with COVID. So that particular verses means a lot to me. What was that experience like, just sitting with your friends and being able to just hear that amazing music for hours on end? Because you all had all of us were stopped in our tracks.
Yeah.
Well, that was like the coming out of Mr. Biggs again.
Yeah.
I had a beard. It's the first time the people see me with a beard. I never wore a beard.
Yeah.
That became so popular. And I wore me and Ernie wore some of our things, you know, chinchilla coat.
y'all showed out.
Y'all was clean. Y'all showed out.
We used to, when we were out on tour back in 75 with the Fight the Power, and Earth, Wind, and Fire hand out That's the Way of the World.
Yeah.
And... wherever we were, Kelly and Ronald had the presidential suite. And after the show, you know, we would all have a tendency to gravitate back to where they were. And people were surprised because they'd come in and hear, "That's the way of the world," in the Isley Brothers suite.
Right.
And we were like, yeah, man, that was nothing else, you know. Playing their music, listening to this stuff all the time. And certainly to be there on the verses with them, that was really closest thing to a musical embrace you could have between Earth, Wind, and Fire and the Isley Brothers, because we were that close in terms of bouncing stuff off of each other musically.
Yeah.
Marvin used to talk to Verdine
all the time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, bass player for Isley's and mm-hmm. bass player for Earth, Wind & Fire. They'd be talking all the time. So, you know, that was a great thing to do, the verses. It was wonderful.
Man, and we were all excited. Steve Harvey was excited.
Yeah.
But we were all excited. Earlier you were talking about how artists today are killing it and they're rapping and singing and all that kind of. I'm curious to know who y'all love in today's music. Besides Alex Isley, of mm-hmm. course, because you have a good reason to love her. She's amazing.
Wow. I like Bruno.
Mm-hmm.
Bruno is
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Yeah, man. They're a great group. Mm-hmm. And we're going to do something with them.
I would
own the Knicks.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah, man. That's amazing, man.
But it's some great people out here, you know. The singer, her.
Yeah.
And mm-hmm. she was influenced by
absolutely
Alex mm-hmm. Isley.
Yeah.
I probably would like to do something with Maxwell.
Ooh. Ooh.
Yeah.
That'd be a great combination.
Yeah.
Yeah, I could hear that.
100%. I would love that.
I want to talk about you all as entrepreneurs, because obviously the album is actually released on your label.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, but also I want to talk about Liquid Gold, mm-hmm. what we've been sipping on the oh, entire oh. episode. This is, by the way.
Let me grab my glass.
I'm
almost done with mine.
It's an XO brandy as well as a vodka, right?
Yeah.
Yep.
I got to tell y'all, I'm not getting no check. I'm telling y'all, one of the best.
It's so good.
This is so smooth.
So good.
Yeah.
So,
it's the vanilla undertones for me.
It's mm-hmm. the vanilla.
Yeah. It's really good.
So why the decision to do Liquid Gold?
You know, we started off to do something with someone in maybe 15 years ago. His family is a French family. And so we never got off the ground with that because of, we wanted to make a split of the profits.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And they didn't want to do that. And we back and forth the contract. So anyway, this came about. This brandy, this lady is from New York. And we talked. We talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. We came up with that.
Mm.
And Contagious is that name.
Mm.
And people in Detroit went crazy. Mm-hmm. I went to Detroit for about 3 or 4 days and went to the television. And people went. It was like me doing a concert.
Wow.
Wow.
More people came to tasting like the Isley Brothers were playing there.
Wow.
Lines all around. I pull up and say, wow. I mean, it was just fantastic.
When it's good, it's good.
All the women tasted the brandy.
Uh-huh.
You know, they don't, like my wife said, they're not into dark liquor, but they went. It's phenomenal. It's
really it good. Is. It really, really is.
Good. It's really good. This is great. If you ever need anybody to help you with additional research or tasting for Liquid Gold, I am available. So just give me a ring. I'll fly back here to St. Louis. Just for the spirit of teamwork. You know.
We were told before that. Okay, so when you get a glass of this of the good stuff, what's the cheers?
Contagious.
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 Make sure you spread that because that's how the word gets out. This is really the real deal. It's
yeah.
good.
Yeah.
It is liquid and gold, all right.
It sneak up on you too.
Yeah. Are you feeling warm inside, Tamone?
Very warm.
Okay, good.
We sound crazy.
I got a question. I would like to know, what are you grateful for today?
That's good. Good question.
Life.
Mm-hmm.
Life.
Yeah, man.
And to be able to try different things, you know, that you wouldn't even think would work one time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm grateful to be living and see my son, 17 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And I taught my wife a lot about this show business. This is why she's sitting over there in the chair now. Ernie's granddaughter.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sounds just as good as her mother.
Mm. Okay.
Alex Isley.
There we go. Now, okay, so you may, we referred to production earlier, but really production is the brilliant Kandy who's off camera right now.
Right.
But you said you were able to teach your wife some of the things about the music business. And the music business is a tricky business.
It's a tricky one.
So I would love to hear some of the things that you've imparted, because I think a lot of artists would also need to hear that advice from you.
Well, she has to, you know, I can't talk to people like every day on the phone about my career, what I want to do, and how great I am. I have to have somebody else do it. And she knows how to do that well.
Yeah.
So well that keep going. We talk about what she should talk about.
Yeah.
And now she can handle that almost by herself.
Yeah.
You know, I always say, what did you do? She said, I told him so and so. That was exactly right.
You handled that.
Yeah.
It's a tough business.
Yeah.
And it's had many, many changes. I mean, throughout, but in the last 20 years especially.
Yeah.
Obviously, we've gone from different kinds of ways to play music, vinyl to CD to now it's all streaming.
Mm-hmm.
What are your feelings on where music is now? With technology and social media and the way people are consuming it. It's a different beast.
I hate streaming.
You do?
Really, because it's not fair to the artist. You know, if, when I first heard about it, I thought it was going to be great.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You get a million streams. So what does that mean?
Right. It don't mean $1 million.
That means 20 cents.
Don't mean that.
35 cents.
Yeah. Wait a minute.
Right.
Wait a minute. Somebody's getting over.
Yes. You know? Yeah.
And the record companies are getting over. But they'll straighten it out.
Yeah.
They'll straighten it out. But I might not be here when they really straighten out, but it's not fair. Yeah. It's not fair.
Ernie, you agree?
Yes. Mm. The streaming thing initially was, I think, was another way for the public to be able to have access to music and to share it.
Mm-hmm.
But when it came time to divvy up royalty-wise, oh, my God.
It's crazy.
For lack of a better phrase,
we never signed anything about
right.
They had to. Who gave them the power?
Yeah. Permission.
Right.
Yeah.
Gave them permission to do that.
That was one of the things that Prince was talking about, you know?
Yes.
And so it's going to take a little while, but.
Yeah.
Prince was so loud about it, right?
Yeah.
And early. And I obviously, I'm not sure everyone was really paying attention, but almost everything he said, all the pitfalls, all the things about record labels and ownership and understanding your business and having control of yourself, they came to pass.
Yeah.
And so in retrospect, I mourn a little differently now because I wish we had listened better.
Mm-hmm.
And I hope that when people see this conversation, that they listen intently.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because while our legends are here, and not just legends because we know them, but because they've been through it. Y'all have been through it.
Yeah.
The advice really matters.
Mm.
So to hear you say your opinions on streaming, it matters more than most because you've seen the different ways that you make money from your music. And if you ain't making money now, something's not right.
I'm interested in knowing, what advice do you give to the Bruno Mars of the world, the Hers, the Alex Isleys, like to have a career, have longevity, for as long as you all have had? Like, what is that one nugget that you can give anybody out there that's looking to have a long career?
Yeah.
Study what you're doing. Mm. Study what you're doing.
Yeah, man.
Study what you're doing.
Yeah.
And try to get some people that's going to be fair with you. If you're dealing with a lawyer, just don't deal with just anybody as a lawyer. Get somebody that you can trust and it's going to be fair with you.
That lawyer part,
get
you a good one.
Yeah.
It's true.
Get you a good one.
Get you a good one.
It's a real thing.
Yeah.
We sound crazy.
One of my favorite songs from the Isley Brothers, the Don't Say Goodnight. Like, was, I want to ask my co-host, putting y'all on the spot. Right, in front right. of the Isley
all
Brothers.
Right, all right, all right.
Let your me, favorite let me Isley Brothers song. For, and it could be your favorite today, because I would say Don't Say Goodnight is my favorite today, because there's okay. so many that I listen to on a frequent, but okay. that is my favorite today.
Wow. I'll go next.
Okay.
What's today, up? It's What's Choosy up? Lover.
Ooh.
Today. Mm-hmm. It changes very often, but today, that and... Yeah, no. Choosy Lover is on today.
Ooh, for me. See, I'm like Claude. It changes from week to week, from month to month. Right now, just knowing that we were coming here and doing this, I've been listening a lot to the Mission to Please
record.
Yeah. Hold back these tears and let me cry. Like, I've said it several times during this interview, like, that era of the Isley Brothers I identify with the most, because that was like, I was discovering music. I was studying music as a kid then. And I'm like, they are making music that I can rock with, you know? So that whole album is just chef's kiss to me.
I'm gonna have to say Footsteps, man. That's where I learned the chords, the chord changes, the pre-hooks and the hooks. It's amazing, man.
You can't go wrong.
Yeah.
And so I guess I'll put the Isley Brothers on the spot.
Right.
What is your favorite song to perform live today? Like, is there such thing as a favorite song out of your vast repertoire, like, to sing live, your favorite?
You're contagious.
Yes, Lord.
Set me free.
Don't make me get on the piano now.
It's right there.
Don't make me do it.
Ernie, what about you?
Ooh. But I want to say, you know, that's one of my songs. But I like...
It's too many.
So many. I'd say Voyage to Atlantis and That Lady.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh,
Voyage to Atlantis. And I have to throw in Summer Breeze, too.
Summer Breeze. Oh, what? I forgot Summer Breeze.
Oh, my God,
Drifting on a memory.
Yeah.
So, of course.
So, today... Do you prefer studio or live?
Wow. I like them both. I like them both. To do the live thing, oh, the audience is, they're so into, from the jump, what we're doing.
Mm-hmm.
So, and as we go along in the show, and you sing something like For the Love of You.
Yeah.
Or
I forgot that one too.
Hello, It's Me.
Mm-hmm.
They're like waiting to hear.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, with fingers crossed. I hope they sing.
Right.
Or I hope they play. You know, then when we hit Voice to Atlantis, it's like, oh, my Lord. You know, so many people. Between the sheets. Come on. It's like, man, they... Just, it's like the music comes that much more alive when you do it in front of the audience. And they have such an appreciation for it. And not to mention, you know, your main man wanna.
Listen.
Keep my heels up.
To this day.
To
this day, that one goes. As a songwriter, do you hear songs that you haven't written? Or when was the last time you heard a song you haven't written and it's been like, damn, I wish I thought of that first. Has that happened recently?
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah? He's like, yeah, a couple times. I'd love to hear that.
Oh, man. I like, whenever I hear it, Jam and Lewis.
Mm.
You're a fake, baby.
Alex O'Neill.
Well, I know.
Yes.
Because I can feel it.
Really?
When I hear that, it's like, yeah, I wish. Whenever I run into it,
I wish I had that.
That we were poor. Please.
I love it.
That was us.
We sound crazy.
I have to ask, Mount Rushmore, right? You got four slots. Mount Rushmore, who is the Isley Brothers Mount Rushmore of music? Like, if you had to say, these four artists belong on Mount Rushmore.
Wow. I would have to say Michael Jackson.
Mm-hmm.
you know, I would have to say Aretha Franklin.
Mm-hmm.
I would have to say Whitney Houston.
Mm-hmm.
And I would have to say, wow, Sam Cooke.
Mm. Mm. Mm.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't even, don't you dare question that.
I mean, you can't.
But I'm going to question Ernie because
he
on the songwriter.
Yes, please.
Mount Rushmore.
Yes, please.
Who would be on your songwriter Hall of Fame or songwriter Mount Rushmore for your four favorite songwriters?
Burt Bacharach and Hal David.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Would certainly mm-hmm. be there. Holland and Dozier and Holland.
Yes, ooh, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Stevie Wonder. Right?
Yeah.
Marvin Gaye.
Yeah. Another list you better not dare question at all.
Yeah.
I would like, since y'all started in gospel music, I would like to know your favorite gospel song of all time.
That's a good question.
Wow.
I like Aretha Franklin. The old landmark, the way she does that. I mean, that takes me all the way back to being a little kid.
Yeah,
I remember
that. And my mother in law, Van, doing that song in church, you know, the old landmark. And the way Aretha does it, it's like it's gospel, but it's, it's raised. You know, the call and response and the lyrics to the song and all mm-hmm. that. And, you know, I gave her another name, another title. One time Ronald had her on the phone and Ronald handed me his phone. I said, you know something? No, you're the queen of soul. It's true. But in addition to that, I want to call you the stone of great price. She started laughing. She said, Ernie, I have no idea how my head is going to be able to lay on my pillow after listening to you. You going there with that? Oh my God. Because a lot of people don't know what the stone of great price is. I said, but that's you. You harmonize with that. You harmonize with the stone of great price. She is, thank you.
Wow.
You know.
From one great to another.
I like the song "Mary, Don't You Weep."
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah, she did. Wow. Showstopper.
Yeah.
Whew. So, you mentioned Holland Dozier Holland. Mm-hmm. You all were with Motown for a short while. What do you remember about that time in your careers?
The first song I did with Motown was This Old Heart of Mine, written with, you know, Holland Dozier. And then, I mean, at that time, everybody, they had the hits of life.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Everybody, the Temptations and
Four Tops,
the Smokey, and wow, you know. And, you know, they were doing the songs with Donna Ross,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and you know, they were just talking about, but this song does just sound like a top 10 song. They didn't want that. They didn't want to do This Old Heart of Mine because they thought that wasn't a number one song.
Mm. Hold on, who didn't think it was the number one song? Diana Ross.
Yeah.
Well, you know, she was so wrong. They passed on it.
They had so many songs.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, we did some songs that the Four Tops did mm-hmm. later. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the reasons we left the company, because I would sing something. I did the Marvin Gaye song.
Okay.
Heard it through the grapevine.
Wow.
Style it that way.
Mm.
And Smokey needed a hit, so Barry came around and said, I want all the songwriters to give their best song to Smokey. For Smokey. And
that's
it. And he did it, and they never released it.
Mm.
You know? And so, we said, we left the company, and I wrote the song, It's Your Thing.
And the rest is history.
The rest is history.
I don't even know what to say at this point. I'm just going to sip on mine.
This is wild, man.
This is insane, man.
Wow. Too contagious, because I'm...
contagious. I had a chance to talk at one time to Lamont Dozier. And he said, I asked him, like, look, man, let me ask you something. How did you all go into a room with a piano and some legal pads and banging them hits out like that, man? Crazy. How did you all do that? And he paused, took a deep breath and said, I was like, that. How? Because my God, the songs they was coming up with, one after hits, just hits everywhere.
Yeah.
I think it's what Ron said, it's God, right? Yeah, it's a God thing.
Yeah. And one person would do something, then the other one would do something, and then, you know, Lamont, he would start off with the piano.
Mm-hmm.
Just playing the rhythm, you know, and then get a rhythm to another guy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know? Yeah.
You can't hurry, love. Oh, you just have to wait. And somebody else say something. It's a game of give and take. And
oh, wow. Pass it around like that?
Jesus. Oh. I didn't know that.
Wow.
Eddie Holland.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Eddie.
I know you want to leave me.
Oh, Eddie.
But I refuse to let you go. So how did you know,
Eddie was one of the greatest singers. He sound like Jackie Wilson, but he wouldn't want to.
Eddie Holland is one of the greatest singers.
Oh, he was one of the greatest singers. His tone sounded like Jackie Wilson.
That's crazy.
Yeah, and when he would be telling you about a song or something, he would sing it.
Mm-hmm.
And you would look at it, man, what are you doing?
Yeah, why aren't you singing it? Right.
He didn't want to be in front of no crowds and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that was amazing.
Oh, man.
You're nice looking. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Man.
And he would sit there and just sing this All of Mine to me. And I'm listening to him sing it. Damn. Yeah,
it's so crazy to hear you talk about vocalists, because you are one of the most original voices ever heard come through my speaker.
Something? Yeah,
I've said this before, I'll say it again. My brother Ronald.
Wow.
Is the greatest male vocalist in the history of rock and roll. With all due respect to everybody else.
Yeah, man.
Thank you.
But I happen to have a brother who is that. Mm-hmm. His name is Ronald.
Yeah, man.
You can start from with the resume if you want to start with Shout, Twist and Shout. Well, John Lennon and the Beatles were doing the three of them. Shake it up, baby. You know. Everybody did this shit thing. Temps, Jackson 5. And you can see as you go, Vanessa Williams with Work to Do, Aliya,
At Your Best
You Are Love. We never released At Your Best You Are Love as a single. Mm. But everybody has had, as a lead vocalist, Ronald Isley as a template.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Like, start there.
Yeah.
Now, you want to go, if you're trying to go somewhere, start there.
Yeah. I have chills right now.
Because the sound will be there.
Yeah.
The hit sound will be there. And the song is there at the same time. So when you had the song and, you know, It's Your Thing was sung on one take, he wrote the song.
Jeez.
The voice of rock and roll.
Come on. It's like, anybody got a bat that's heavier than that one?
How do you all feel about do you all feel like you get the rightful credit that you deserve for being
who you are?
Who you are and the voice of rock and roll? Like, you all started it all.
I think we get the credit from our people.
Yeah.
Mm. Our people, they know.
Yeah. They know. Mm.
But not with everybody.
Mm. Yeah. Mm. That's the purpose. That's why we were so grateful for you guys being willing to sit with us. Because, you know, as the times
change.
Some of
the things that they know about, what they don't mention. They don't want to mention it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, like you guys would mention all the rappers. Mm-hmm. They don't want to mention that.
Yeah.
You know how important that is?
Yeah.
Very. All the rappers that do your music.
Yeah.
Hey, man, what kind of catalog? Well, if you got all the rappers doing your music, and why are you giving all $500 million to so and so and so?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Who did theirs?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, but they do what they do because they do what they do, mm-hmm. Whatever that is, you know. Mm. But I can say our people. You know, if our people had the money to spend, like some other people have, mm-hmm. you would have zillions of people at your shows.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but they don't have that kind of money.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
you know, but what they do have is amazing.
Yeah,
it's amazing, and that's why I can. Put a bottle like that contagious,
mm-hmm.
and a couple of years from now, you look back at it and say, "Wow, look where that is."
Yeah, mm-hmm.
but it's gonna start with our people.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. It always does.
It always does.
The Esther Roll
Award.
I can feel him moving. I can feel him moving on the altar of my heart. Every now and then.
All right, so a little backstory on that right there. The amazing Esther Roll, the actress.
And singer.
Has a gospel album, and that's off her gospel album. It's called The Garden of My Mind. It came out on Savoy Records.
75, right?
In
1975.
75, right? Yeah. And we didn't know that until Tamone here told us that. And that got us to talking about all the black entertainers, black people in our business that don't necessarily get the attention and love they deserve for their contributions to this culture. You all have been architects of rock and roll and relevant in every decade since you guys came out.
Exactly.
So there is nobody who knows the behind the scenes and the in front of camera people that have really worked hard in this business. So we wanted to create a segment in our podcast where we honored, nominated and voted and honored people that we felt could use a little more love. And we do this every single episode and we vote on it. And it's always people that we really kind of forget that, like, wow, this done a whole lot of stuff. So we would love to do it today.
Yeah. Are you kidding me?
I'm explaining.
It's a no-brainer.
All I'm doing is explaining the segment. So, I have said nothing.
So this is, I mean, I'm sitting next to music royalty. Rock and roll, they've influenced everybody from the Beatles.
100%.
To 2 Chainz. When you think about it, I mean, that's a wide gap.
Yeah.
Decades.
Yes.
It's the Isley Brothers.
It's no question.
I
just wanted to know what it was so they know what they were getting.
Yeah.
Listen, if you've gotten the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and so you should
the
know
Songwriters Hall of Fame.
You should know what the
Esther
Roll Black Excellence Award is.
Yeah, the We Sound Crazy Award we're going to give it to you so you can put it on the mantle right next
to the other important awards you have. But the bottom line is we want to take a time in our episode to honor artists that have changed the game, influenced not only us, but the world. Mm. And I can't think of better nominees and winners than you two, the Isley Brothers. And I'm gonna say this, the Isley family.
Yeah.
Mm. Yes.
The Isley legacy has changed the game. And so there's no vote to take here.
Yeah, salute.
It's unanimous. We just want to honor you and thank you for the time and the gems you've shared in the last hour or so.
And I want to thank you for the liquid. Oh, the contagious. Personally, I just want to thank you.
That's really what touched your heart?
It touched my heart. Okay. I mean, the catalog and all the contribution. But no, seriously, your impact on American music.
Yes.
Yeah, man.
And the world, for that matter. It's just, it's the soundtrack of all of our lives.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm sitting here trying to, like, fight back tears because I think about just all of those years being at my grandmother's house, being at my aunt's house.
Yeah.
And them literally schooling us on the Isley Brothers, playing Fight the Power, playing Harvest for the World, playing Between the Sheets.
Yeah.
Make Me Say It Again, Girl. Mm-hmm. Like, those amazing records. Like, man, it's just, I'm truly honored. Like, thank you so much.
And y'all still doing it today.
Still.
Today.
And let me just add, as Black men who are constantly looking for role models and people to look up to in a business that's really hard in general, but hardest, I think, on Black artists, you guys have set the tone and the bar so high. That's what I'm grateful for, because a lot of times we're looking for mentors and all I have to do is put that music on. And it reminds me that I got it. Everything you said, study, write amazing songs, work at your craft, evolve.
Keep God first.
So the chills, I feel the chills because the gratitude is real.
Is this the chance where I, because Ron and Ernie, I also sing.
Oh my Lord.
So is this the moment?
They're already laughing, Phil.
I mean, could they collaborate? Maybe the next one.
Trying to get on the next album.
I'm just going to put it out there now.
Maybe if you show up like 2 Chainz did.
That's what I'm going to do.
You got to wear leather, though.
You got to wear leather.
Hey, say less. Make sure you follow us on all platforms at We Sound Crazy and WeSoundCrazy.com. Special thanks to our friends at Visit Music City. Thank you for your continued support.
Yes. And we got to, like I said, productions, but I want to shout out Kandy.
Yeah.
Yes.
Because you're the glue.
Yeah, you made it happen for us.
In every way. Yeah. Thank you for the hospitality.
Yes.
For the kindness, for opening your home and all these things to us. It's more than you had to do. Yeah. And we're really grateful for you as
Thank
well.
You, Kandy.
Thank you very, very much. When we close our episodes out, we ask our illustrious special guests to choose the going out song. It can be anything you want it to be, but anything that you feel, a song that you feel takes out this episode in conversation. What would you all choose? Actually, I want to hear from both of you what song you choose individually.
I'd say Between the Sheets.
Mm. Between the Sheets.
Wow, that's it. Obviously, the same thing. I'm going to sing, I like it when you call me.
So the original and the Biggie version.
Yeah, man.
What's the mashup?
The mashup.
I can get with that.
Yeah, man.
And before we go, I got to talk about this amazing vinyl of the album right now. You can get the vinyl or the CD. Yep.
Yes, you can.
On Amazon. It's available on Amazon. That's where I ordered mine. I actually ordered it. It was here in like a day.
You see?
Mm-hmm.
So.
It's called good service, right?
It's called good service, but you got to hear this on vinyl. Like, nothing against the streaming, but hearing that physical just on the record
buy
player.
Buy it. And support music.
Yes, we have to.
We have to. You heard what they said about streaming. You got to buy that. Buy the record. And then, you see this? We've been talking about it the whole time.
Liquid Gold, Contagious.
For an amazing episode.
How about that?
With icons, legends, and all around amazing people. We want to say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. To Contagious.
To Contagious, man.
To Contagious.
God bless y'all.
Yeah.
Until next time.
And hit up the website at the bottom of the screen as well. RonaldIsleyLiquidGold.com.
Get it. It's right here at the bottom of the screen. What you waiting for? Until next time, y'all. Cheers.
Cheers.
To Contagious.
We sound crazy. We out of here, y'all. St. Louis. Chuck, you ain't disappoint.
You didn't disappoint, Chuck.
You know I ain't disappoint. I never
through.
Disappoint.
You came through. Love y'all.
Love y'all.
When you call me Big Pop, throw your hands in the air if you's a true player.